dive into Ripple there. Now what we're going to do is we're going to do, I guess, an exploration more of blockchain and cryptocurrency. So if I could invite our moderator, Stefan Kimmel, executive partner, financial services from IBM, to the stage. Gustavo Montero, chairman of Agar Development, our former CEO of Standard Chart. Lisa Nestor, partnerships director, Stellar.org. How's it going, Lisa? I'm gonna butcher this, so I already apologize, Mr. Salvador. Gonzalo Salvador. I've spent most of my time in Asia, not in Spain. Fernandez, vice president, Internet of Things.
From Duke. And I'm not from the country. It's Portugal, not Spain.
From Portugal. Oh my gosh! I've even ruined that. I've been to Portugal too. And John Hensel, EVP and COO of Securrency. Welcome. Thanks. Come on, warm round of applause. Let's go.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Yeah. Get a bit closer to the mic just. So thank you very much and welcome to today's discussion. Clearly, cryptocurrencies and blockchain have been one of the hottest, if not the hottest topic in financial services over the last 5 years. We've seen the meteoric rise of Bitcoin and the subsequent fall of it. We've seen Ripple build highways. We've seen a lot of private sector companies and governments release their own projects, their own protocols, their own cryptocurrencies. As of late, we've, in connection to the fall of some of the valuations, a stronger call for regulation, or even voices that want to ban cryptocurrencies altogether in certain markets. So what we'd like to do today, together with my distinguished panelists, and I thank you very much for joining me today on stage, shed some light on the view of financial services, of the financial services industry, on cryptocurrencies, as well as the state of adoption as we've seen it so far. May I just, for everybody's benefit, ask each of you for just a very brief introduction of yourselves and your organizations, please. Gustavo.
All right. My name is Gustavo Montero. I'm the chairman of Agar LLC. Agar is a company based in the UAE. We build blockchain companies and we issue cryptocurrency. But prior to that, I was the head of Standard Charter. I opened the bank in Switzerland. And then I was on the board of directors of Cramer. And for some years, I was also an auditor trained by Pricewaterhouse. But my origin in terms of education is I'm an engineer by training.
I'll go ahead.
Lisa.
Great. Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for your time. My name is Lisa Nestor. I work at Stellar.org. We're a San Francisco-based blockchain company, so comparable to Bitcoin, Ethereum, Ripple, in terms of being an infrastructure player in the industry. I think that's probably about it. My background, I spent about 5 years working in the financial inclusion space, 2 years in West Africa, 3 years in India. After that, studied business and worked in the fintech sector for a few years before moving on to Stellar.
Thank you, Lisa.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Gonzalo Fernandez, and I'm responsible for the IoT solutions and blockchain portfolio within Du, which is a telecom operator here in the UAE. My experience has been mainly on technologies. Prior to joining Du, I was responsible for cloud services for Portugal Telecom, and before that, HP.
Good afternoon. My name is John Hensel. I'm a co-founder and COO of Securrency, Inc. Securrency is a U.S.-based company. We have a wholly owned subsidiary here in the MENA region, where I'm the senior executive officer of that team. We're both a RegTech and a FinTech company. We provide regulatory compliance services to financial markets. We're very excited, of course, to be operating here in the GCC and excited to be delivering our services here to help fuel innovation and bring value from many illiquid assets into the market to be able to drive innovation in the region.
Thank you very much, everybody. So Gustavo, let's start with you. Since you are a trained engineer and you've been building companies in both spaces, could you shed some light, please, on the difference between blockchain and cryptocurrency and whether one can work without the other?
A very basic question, but I'm sure there are many people here highly technical, they know that, but for the ones that don't, blockchain is simply a technology. We're going to speak about that, I guess, in detail. And that technology can produce a cryptocurrency. There are currently over 1,600 cryptocurrencies in the world. People only speak about Bitcoin, but there are many, many. So there are two different parts of this world, and obviously blockchain can work without cryptocurrency. You don't need to issue a crypto if you're building a blockchain-based company.
Thank you very much. Lisa, from your practical experience, how do you see the adoption of cryptocurrencies by financial markets? How far are we, and where do you see challenges coming up, or is still already there?
Sure. So if it's okay, I'll take a minute to just give a little bit more detail on the space that Stellar is operating in, sure. And then I can talk about adoption there. So as a blockchain ledger, a couple of things to understand about Stellar is that we're a public blockchain ledger. We're not permissioned. We do have a native asset called Lumens. I think it's the eighth largest globally right now. And what we do is facilitate multi-asset transactions. I think that's the best way to describe it. So with Stellar's infrastructure, you can digitize any type of financial asset. The process of doing that is quite straightforward. And in addition, our ledger has a built-in decentralized exchange, which means that suddenly you can have a blockchain ledger that has many different types of digital assets. This can be digitized fiat. We do a lot of work in the cross-border payments space. Or it can be other types of financial assets. This includes ICOs, as well as things like digitized bonds, digitized real estate, equity, commodities, really the sky's the limit. And that doesn't even include things like loyalty points, airtime minutes. And so you start to see this very compelling and exciting new type of financial infrastructure where all these digital assets can be traded and kind of as was mentioned, see a lot of interesting evolution in terms of liquidity between these different types of assets. So adoption we've seen to kind of be pacing a little bit differently across different parts of the financial sector. Personally, I spend a lot of time in the money transfer industry. In fact, I just came from the Global Money Transfer Summit, where we've been for the last 2 days. And in that regard, we're seeing a tremendous amount of adoption and interest from money transfer companies. We also spend quite a lot of time talking to banks, but because MTOs tend to be very squarely focused on payments and very acutely aware of all of the pain points in that process right now, they're very eager to adopt technologies that can reduce cost, increase speed, provide alternative means of settlement through crypto assets. And then I guess just lastly, you know, obviously there's been an explosion in the ICO space. You know, next to Ethereum, Stellar is probably the second most popular infrastructure for issuing any type of security-style asset. There's a lot of maturity that needs to happen in that market right now, and you know, we love seeing companies like Securrency helping to provide that in the ecosystem. But that's certainly a space where we're seeing a ton of movement. And then, you know, in other types of the financial sectors, you know, issuance of bonds or other types of assets. We're actually seeing a lot of adoption and interest. So a lot of companies moving forward with that. So you know, I would say overall, it's you know, it's slow growth because you do need an ecosystem to make these markets really make sense. But with each new partner, the pace of that adoption increases because it's that much more compelling.
It's actually a very beautiful transition over to John. I mean, you are serving asset managers around the world. What role would you say crypto and distributed ledger technologies play for asset management, both globally as well as specifically in the region?
Well, there's a couple of important points, and Gus and Lisa both touched on both the power of the technology to be able to perform transactions very efficiently and a variety of different types of assets. I mean, with 1,600 cryptocurrencies in circulation today, you know, regulators have certainly signaled the likelihood that many of them are actually securities and therefore need to be treated as such, regulated in the respective jurisdiction, and that certain participants are eligible to hold, trade, or transfer those. So compliance is a significant part of where the markets are going. Technology makes a lot of things possible. Compliance and regulation is what protects investor interests along the way. So being able to provide a service in financial markets, to portfolio managers, fund managers, asset managers, to efficiently be able to form capital and then create liquidity in a secondary market for those assets to be traded very efficiently is primarily our focus. So we start with identifying the individual. Identity proofing is critical in the process of regulation. You know, compliance and anonymity cannot go together. Compliance and privacy can. So being able to do the KYC, AML, accreditation, verification, all of those services on the front end to qualify participants in the market, and then use those resources to be able to create credentialed secondary markets. Securrency's solution is ledger agnostic. We operate with Stellar, with Ripple, with Ethereum, Hashgraph in the future. All kinds of ledger technologies are going to come along. We want to remain agnostic to those and be able to adopt the best features of each.
Thank you. So Gonzalo, we've predominantly talked about financial services so far. Now Du is one of the main sponsors of this event, or the main sponsor. Can you shed some light, please, on your involvement, your activity in the space?
Sure. I'm not here to announce the launch of a new cryptocurrency called DuCoin. No, that's not the purpose. So Du is always looking for innovative and disruptive technologies to support our customers in terms of their digitalization journeys and to improve business outcomes. So we jumped on the opportunity where we were invited back in 2015 to join the Dubai Blockchain Council and to learn a bit about this disruptive technology. Going to your initial point about blockchain and cryptocurrencies, we like to call it distributed ledger technologies, not to be linked to the Bitcoin discussion. And since then, we've been deploying a lot of POCs, proof of concepts, together with some partners like IBM. We've been very active on the health space, where we do some very secure electronic health records from the device all the way to the central system and the way it traveled across different medical institutions. For financial services, with IBM, we did a POC for trade finance and logistics with Dubai Customs and White Trade, as well as Banco Santander and Emirates NBD here locally. And also we dwelled into the loyalties field with a company called Loyal. And basically our positioning as a telecom operator is as an enabler. All these systems need to run on something in the end. So basically that's where we tend to be, position ourselves, and then look for the best partners and the most advanced ones in which to partner and go to the market. And this is a very, very dynamic field. So I remember when I started doing talks on blockchain, typically we had probably one third of the room. Now we have a packed room. So it's great to see how the momentum is behind technology, but also to keep pace with this innovative space is something that we struggle on to achieve on a day-to-day basis.
So clearly, the answer is very active in a wide range of opportunities. That's fantastic to hear. Gustavo, back to you. You've been a banker for many, many years in a supposedly conservative country such as such as Switzerland. How is cryptocurrency viewed by the financial services industry, and where do you see main use cases or value areas, at least in the early stages of the adoption of crypto on the blockchain?
That's a very good question. I think you have to start by the fact that bankers do not understand cryptocurrency and blockchain technology. The reality is that myself as an ex-banker, I'm still totally plugged into the financial environment, both in Switzerland and in the UK mostly. And I speak regularly to my friends working in banks, and I understand that they don't know nothing about it. And they're trying to search for answers. The only people that know about these technologies inside a bank are the CTOs, and to an extent, but many of the CTOs have no idea what blockchain is anyway. And so it is really infant. The reality is that the perception in banking of this new technology is simply crazy. They don't know what to think about it yet. There was a gentleman from Ripple here before, and he was providing some very useful information. And it is through that type of information, the one that you can provide as well, Lisa, and the other members here, that bankers will understand. For the moment, I would say that the great majority of bankers don't have a real view of it because they don't know what it is, and mostly they're afraid because they think they're going to lose their jobs.
Indeed.
That's a view.
So Lisa, may I ask, I mean, you have a lot of practical experience in implementing this. What are some of the main success stories, the most successful implementations you've seen, the successes so far? And perhaps even, if you may, differentiated by in emerging markets, which pro- probably is an easier starting point for adoption, as well as in some of the developed industrialized markets?
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, the thing is that with payments, the majority of the transactions go from a developed market to an emerging market, at least in the remittance sector, right? Yes. So certainly in B2B payments and other areas, that's potentially not true. So, you know, it takes two to tango, and so you generally have one in both of those markets. But yeah, I mean, there's a ton of really compelling use cases. I think maybe something that kind of going back to the cryptocurrency, the utilization of crypto. So with the Stellar network, in terms of payments, you know, there's a lot of advantages that one can see from simply integrating onto the network, having, you know, now a very accessible network of partners that you're technically compatible with. You know, it's a good opportunity to with one integration, grow the number of cash out partners or origination partners that you're working with, which is all very exciting. But really the holy grail in this space is real-time settlement, right? I mean, that is what I think bankers understand too, although they don't know exactly how to get there. They certainly have no idea how to hold a crypto asset on their balance sheet, and I think have a lot of fear with regulators about what that will be like. But, you know, again, because of that, that's why we've been more interested in working with mid to large size money transfer operators that have a lot of pain points when it comes to settlement right now. So an example of this is, if I'm a European MTO and I want to be able to provide instant payments to my customers in 10 different countries, oftentimes that means that I need to have $100,000 to $500,000 worth of capital pre-funded with a partner in these countries. And that really starts to add up. That's a huge amount of capital that you're using, that you're not really using, I guess is the way to put that, that's float that, you know, a bank probably appreciates being able to hold, but many would argue that it's not a great utilization of capital. And with crypto asset, with Lumens and the Stellar network, you have the ability to settle a payment on a transaction by transaction basis fully, meaning the value is transferred from the originator to the receiver in 3 to 5 seconds without that need for pre-funding. And so when we first started money transfer on Stellar, you know, a year and a half ago, our MTOs, you know, they were kind of just dipping their toe in the water when it came to utilization of a crypto asset for settlement. A lot of them wanted to use the blockchain, but just use, you know, a fiat to fiat trade and still kind of settle the transaction using the correspondent banking network. But now those institutions are some of our most bullish advocates for use of crypto for payments now. Our oldest users of the network now say to me, only introduce me to new partners that want to do crypto-based settlement, because they're really seeing the value and they understand it now. And I would totally agree that, unfortunately, because this is infrastructure level innovation, there's a big educational curve. And we have to make people understand how these new markets work in order to make them very comfortable in utilizing it. But I would say, in my opinion, that's a use case that I get very excited about, where, you know, there's some hesitation, but then there's a lot of growth and excitement about not just the use of blockchain, but the use of crypto assets for real-time settlement between different players on the ecosystem.
Absolutely. So John, obviously regulation plays a huge role and it will increasingly going forward in this space. You talk to regulators both globally as well as here in the region. How do you see the financial services marketplaces of the future shape up in this regard?
Well, that's an excellent point, because without the authorizations that the regulators provide, these markets can't exist. Similarly, though, regulators are watching market behavior. They're trying to see what's possible. Their focus, of course, is always investor interests first, and that's where they need to start. So the current rules, the current laws that are in place have to be adhered to. Over time, as markets become better understood, we may see change or transition in some of those rules to make markets more efficient. But presently, of course, you need to comply with the current rules. A great deal of credit to the regulators, particularly in this region. As we heard this morning, the announcement coming from the Financial Services Regulatory Authority and the Abu Dhabi Global Market of their spot crypto asset initiative, both for exchanges and for additional services, to be able to put a regulatory framework in place to be able to create a regulated market where crypto can be exchanged efficiently is a very innovative move, and one that I think is a first step of probably many in the region that will begin to help transition financial services here from traditional fiat to crypto assets. Building off of that, of course, is, as we spoke a moment ago, the idea of tokenized securities and the ability to transfer value in an income-producing asset, like a real estate investment trust, a power purchase agreement, accounts receivable portfolios or startups that traditionally have been held as private placements. They've been largely illiquid assets. To be able to take those and transfer them as tokenized assets efficiently on blockchain, on distributed ledger, from one party to another in a regulatory compliant way will absolutely transform financial markets. And particularly in a region like the UAE, where a significant amount of wealth is held in illiquid assets, real estate being one of those, to be able to unlock that value and now make monetizing those assets very efficient, very convenient, and still safe and secure could be incredibly important, particularly in a region where carbon-based economies need to evolve to something else, whether it be aerospace or healthcare or the next tech that comes along. This is a fantastic catalyst for that kind of change. So credit to ADGM for seeing this as a stepping stone. You mentioned other regulators around the globe. Of course, the Securities and Exchange Commission in the United States is generally the gold standard from which most regulators look to see how markets should be regulated. And our engagement there tells us that they are certainly looking to adopt these types of technologies. Again, they want to make sure the present laws can be adhered to, and technologies that are beginning, fintech companies, regtech companies that are out there, like Securrency, that can begin to provide that environment, is going to help to unlock and open up those markets.
Thank you. Now, Gustavo, you've been saying, of course, financial services establishment is not necessarily the fastest to understand and adopt and embrace new technologies. Nevertheless, I mean, we have seen quite a lot of activities in the area being started, be it smaller POCs, be it trial and error, be it test. How fast do you see the adoption continuing, and where do you see potential roadblocks or pitfalls in the further adoption?
I think that question goes back into the regulatory environment, and there is something which is, I'd like to bring this up to you so you know now what's coming. There is going to be also a change in the regulatory environment in the financial world here. And it's called triple entry accounting. You never heard of it, as most people. 1,000 years ago, we invented single entry accounting. 500 years ago, we invented double entry accounting, debits and credits. And now we are speaking about triple entry accounting. That means the following. When a block is accepted, there's a final entrance on those books that close the transaction completely. So I think that the adoption, which is going back to your point, is going to be relatively slow. That's my view of it, because there are going to have to be substantial changes in the accounting. You see, up to now, as an ex-auditor, before being a banker, I was an auditor. I tell you, we always work according to GAAP. It's just principles that we all use. Now we're going to have to use GAAP with triple entry. You understand the mess that this is going to create. So I think that adoption is going to go slow. There are going to be some specific areas, niche areas, where perhaps we're going to go very fast. But overall, the regulatory environment and the financial regulatory environment will go slow when it comes to crypto and blockchain companies. I build blockchain companies. I issue cryptocurrency through Agar, RLLC. I would like it to go fast, like all of us, I suppose. But I think it's going to go slow, and it's going to take some time before this thing really keeps going. And I said, watch out for triple entry accounting, which is a term that most of us don't even know about, but it's new, it's there, and it's going to be integrated into the regulatory space, financial regulatory space of blockchain and cryptocurrency.
Lisa, in terms of the value, I mean, you've obviously touched on we've heard in this and the previous discussion, some of the values that cryptocurrencies can probably bring to financial transactions. What's the main value you see, both in the international as well as domestic transactions, you see cryptocurrencies bring?
Sure, absolutely. So in my opinion, there's two very important pieces of value that a crypto asset like Lumens will bring. So the first I already touched on, which is real-time settlement, being able to fully transfer a value between essentially two digital credits, digital IOUs that are tied to a specific institution, but through the trade of those two credits, utilization of a crypto asset to fully settle that transaction. And, you know, I don't want to understate how incredibly important that value is for the payments industry. A secondary one that I think is maybe even more interesting and compelling is somewhat particular to Stellar, but because we have a decentralized exchange and you can issue any type of financial asset into that network. In fact, right now we have over 2,000 assets which have been issued into the Stellar network. We're averaging 15 to 20 new assets being added every day, right? Some of these might be like a Lisa handshake or something, and there may be more experimental things, but there are very high quality assets that are included in this. And so what that means is you have a lot of different assets moving around in these exchanges, and there's a value that a native crypto asset can bring in helping to make very liquid markets, right? Meaning that it would be insane for me to have so many one-to-one pairs, right? Whether this is going between all of these different fiat assets or it's wanting to go from, you know, a fiat asset to a security, et cetera, you can't have so many permutations of one-to-one orders in a network. But when you have a bridge crypto asset, that as long as your issued asset is being traded against that crypto asset, it can then be bought or sold for any other asset that's also being traded for Lumens or that crypto asset, you know, assuming authorization, right? So being able to act as this bridge currency between all of the different fiat assets and non-fiat assets that are being issued and traded inside of these networks, I think is a huge and very interesting marketplace. We'll continue to see it evolve.
It's more being signaled, we're almost running out of time. I have one last question that I'd like.
Just before you jump into that, I just want to pick up on the adoption question,
sure,
because I slightly disagree with Gustavo. I think the pace will be slow. However, as you mentioned, there are niches that are going to grow at a very fast speed. And we briefly touched on terms of challenges. You mentioned the lack of knowledge. It's one in terms of the bank that needs to be worked on, but also regulatory. But within these constraints, I strongly feel, and I've seen it in the market here, that there are areas where we can perceive another use cases. We talked a lot about cryptocurrencies, but we should talk also about KYC, for example, use cases for banks in terms of using DLT technologies there, as well as settlement, interbank settlement. So we see these as low-hanging fruits, and we've seen the industry grow a lot from 2015, 16, 17, the POC years, to 2018, and when we're starting to see the first production environments. So yes, I think that overall adoption in terms of payments and cryptocurrencies by banks will take time because of the regulatory environment, also the knowledge gap. But in terms of other use cases, then I think that it will be fairly quick.
So since you almost touched on 2019, you stopped at 2018, and we heard it's 2,400 cryptocurrencies in the market. I'll ask you all, and we hold you personally responsible in a year's time. How many cryptocurrencies will we have in a year's time when we come together again? Any rough and crazy wild guess? More or less? 1 year. Oh, you can go 3 years if you want.
let me tell you what I think. We have now 1,600, more or less, cryptocurrencies, give and take. Huh? There's one every new day. I think that in 10 years, there's going to be very few. And my view of it, if there's going to be a single or two cryptocurrencies per industry, that's what I think we're going to go into. I'm just going to say a wild thing. Maybe Amazon crypto, if they ever come with it, it's going to be the retail cryptocurrency or something like that. But I think that in 10 years, the scope will be severely reduced, but not immediately. As a matter of fact, we're going to see more cryptocurrencies
more first
coming up right now.
Yeah.
But just want to mention something else. I saw walking into this room Pierre-Yves Luca, who's somewhere there. This guy is in our legal team. He's the man to ask questions when it comes to regulatory and particularly legals. I encourage you to go and see him because he probably has all the answers I don't have.
Sure. So the term cryptocurrency to me means a native asset from a blockchain ledger. So I think 10 years from now, we'll see a large reduction in that. I do think that there's an overabundance of blockchains and that's going to go down. However, I do fully believe that we're moving towards a tokenized financial economy. And so I think that there could be hundreds of thousands of different digital assets, but many less cryptocurrencies.
I share the view of my panelists, but I think that they subtly touch here upon a few points, which is tokenization, digital coins, cryptocurrencies. We never got a bit into the details on the differences between, but I do believe there will be fewer and fewer, and that will be driven also as we move on beyond proof of work blockchains into more proof of stakes that will not probably require as much cryptocurrencies as incentive, but also in terms of the market itself. And at its peak, we reached 900 billion in terms of market value for these digital currencies, which is nothing compared to the 90 trillion of money supply. But I do believe that the number will go down.
And I certainly agree with my colleagues here. The number will go down. The number of ledgers will likely go down as well. Ledgers are going to evolve. They're going to become faster. They're going to become more capable. So there's exciting times ahead for financial markets as we begin to bring on alternative assets into those spaces to include tokenized securities, where you now have an income-producing asset. It's a wonderful form of value. So when your money is at rest, it's paying you a dividend. And when you need your money in motion, you can instantly monetize it and transfer it to another form. This is a something that seems quite futuristic, but it's really just a few months away. It will be here before we know it.
Right. Thank you so much. Unfortunately, we're already out of time. Thank you so much for sharing this. Very interesting discussion. I thank you very much.